Today we gather with palms in hand to commemorate Christ's triumphant ride into Jerusalem, and we greet him not only as Messiah on this feast day, but also as King. And this is an important aspect of our celebration of Palm Sunday because this is exactly how the people of Jerusalem greeted him 2,000 years ago. This crowd had just witnessed the miracle of Lazarus being raised from the dead, and for this reason, they understood Jesus as being the long-promised Messiah. And there's also a fulfillment of prophecy in this moment, which foretold that the coming one would enter as, quote, triumphant and victorious, humble and riding on the foal of a donkey. So the people standing about, waving palms of victory, had every reason to believe that Jesus was their promised king. But their hopes were misdirected slightly, in that they believed that the coming Messiah would usher in a physical kingdom here on earth. They believed Jesus would enter Jerusalem as a conquering king. And this is where their expectation missed the mark. From the beginning of his public ministry, Jesus consistently told those to whom he ministered that God's kingdom is not of this world. The kingdom does not come as something one observes, Jesus tells a group of Pharisees in Luke 17. For look, the kingdom of God is within you. Standing before Pilate in John 18, Jesus says very plainly, my kingdom does not belong to this world. If my kingdom belonged to this world, my followers would be fighting to keep me from being handed over to the Jews. But as it is, my kingdom is not from here. Now, perhaps most striking is the moment Jesus was led into the desert to be tempted by Satan following a 40-day period of fasting. After being led to the top of a mountain, the adversary shows him all the kingdoms of the world shining in their glory. And very slyly, Satan leans in and whispers to Jesus, I will give you all of this, if only you bow down and worship me. Now, if Jesus was truly interested in the glory of earthly kingdoms, this story would have turned out much different. But you and I already know how the story ends. Jesus shuns the lure of earthly power, and he tells the devil to bugger off. And the desert fathers and mothers of our church tell us that the adversary, in this episode, he used these particular forms of temptation to get Jesus to question his identity as the Son of God. And likewise for us, temptation can greet us in subtle ways that might get us to question who we are as followers of Christ, or perhaps even to question our understanding of God's goodness, or even what it means to participate in the kingdom of God. C.S. Lewis illustrates the subtleness of such tempting moments like this in his book, The Screwtape Letters, which has largely been overlooked in Orthodox circles. In the book, Lewis creates a fictional account of an elder demon writing to a younger apprentice demon on the best methodologies for distracting Christians from the practice of their Christian faith. In an early chapter, the elder demon tells the apprentice to remember, the safest road to hell is the gradual one, the gentle slope, soft underfoot, without sudden turnings away, without milestones, and without signposts. Now, this fictional write-up, I think, gets to the heart of the matter because it speaks to the notion of misdirection. Misdirection can greet us in ways that appear perfectly sound, but in reality is a subtle twist on the truth of things. And if we question the truth of things slowly, over time, subtly, we might wind up much further adrift from where we'd ever expected we'd be. Here's another example from the Screwtape Letters that helps illustrate the point. The elder demon instructs that the best thing, wherever possible, is to keep the human from serious intent of praying altogether. And the simplest way is to turn their gaze away from God and toward themselves. Keep them watching their own minds and trying to produce feelings by their action of their own will. When they meant to ask God for charity, let them instead start trying to manufacture charitable feelings for themselves and to not notice that this is what they're doing. When they say they are praying for forgiveness, let them be trying to feel forgiven. Teach them to estimate the value of each prayer by their success in producing a desired feeling. Now, what exactly does all this have to do with Palm Sunday? If we hearken back to the Judeans waving palms and cheering forth the man they expect to ride in and defeat the Romans, that is, to establish the nation of Israel here on earth, well, this expectation is a type of misdirection characterized in the Lewis quote from above, to turn their gaze away from God and toward themselves. The people of Judea, they're not interested in the goodness of the kingdom that Jesus promises. They want a Messiah who will bring them political liberation. Their desire is a God who will give them what they want, a God in their own image. And here today, we don't have to think too hard on this concept to understand it, because these same attitudes are present to us here in the Orthodox Church of today. One example is the growing devotion to Christian nationalism here in America, which is nothing more than a distraction from or misdirection from the actual teachings of Jesus about the kingdom of God. The reason we have all gathered here this day to celebrate, and the reason the church has continued to commemorate this Palm Sunday for 2,000 years, is because we once chose faith in Christ through baptism. And lest we never forget that when we were baptized into our own death. And it was through baptism that we agreed to make Christ the Lord over every aspect of our lives. And therefore, we cannot die to Christ and take up his cross while swearing allegiance to earthly kingdoms. God's kingdom, by contrast, we pray for those who persecute us. We shun power. We feed the hungry. We clothe the naked. We do not take up arms against our enemies, and we see all people as fellow humans created in the image of God. There is no earthly kingdom that upholds any of these practices. And make no mistake, Christian nationalism is nothing more than a repackaged version of an earthly kingdom decorated with religious imagery. It is the very temptation Satan offered to Jesus in the wilderness. The Apostle Paul exhorts us in today's epistle to keep your hearts and your minds on Christ Jesus. Whatever is true, whatever is honorable, whatever is just, whatever is pure, think about these things. This is the kingdom. And we must always remember that it is not we who define these concepts. For if we lean too far into what we think is good and true and right, we risk being easily led away from or misdirected from the real Christ, which is exactly what happened to those who greeted Christ with palms 2,000 years ago. Once they realized Jesus wasn't interested in their version of the kingdom, well, it takes only a few days before they begin to cry aloud for his death. Let us not yearn for the earthly reign of a political leader or religious zealot, but rather let us run to meet the true Jesus Christ. St. Andrew of Crete tells us, he is coming who is everywhere present and pervading all things. He is coming to achieve in you the work of universal salvation. Let us run to meet him as he hastens toward his passion, and then we shall be able to receive the word at his coming, and God, whom no limits can contain, will be with us. In the name of the Father, the Son, and the Holy Spirit. Amen.